So, Daizan here from Zenways. Been asked to talk a little bit about the Buddha's Eightfold Path, his practice sequence. And we're going to talk today a little bit about right view, which is the first of the eight steps. We can view it also actually as the last of the eight steps as well. The classical symbol for the Buddhist path, which goes way, way back, is the eight-spoked wheel. So each step can be viewed as leading on to the next, leading back to the first. There's a cyclical quality about the steps. So right view, beginning, end, very important step. So what do we mean by right view? So the word Buddha means the person who is awake. Right view is an awakened view, a view that's awake to the truth of things. It's the opposite of somebody being asleep. So when we're asleep, we're in a dream. Might be a nightmare, but we're in a dream. The waking up process, which is the beginning, middle, and end of the Buddhist path as a path, involves, in the Buddha's expression of it, the beginnings of it is a recognition of a potential, things not being optimal. This is often phrased in terms of suffering or in terms of stress. There's a term, dukkha, that comes from the early texts, which translates quite well as stress or suffering. The Buddha's first noble truth is suffering exists. There is suffering. So what does this mean on a personal level? We can think of suffering, stress, as separation. What in philosophy gets called alienation, a sense of me against the world. In this me against the world mindset, there's an inherent and inevitable stress because it's an unequal struggle. I'm so much smaller than the world. The world is so seemingly cruel and indifferent to me. My life is very limited. My contribution is very limited. My power, even if I'm a very major dictator, is still very limited. So necessarily, we are, in this sense, suffering. So our right view, the beginnings of our right view, is really kind of arising within this sense of things are not optimal. A sense of a potential, perhaps, that's not being fulfilled. A piece that's missing. Now, in terms of people who come and practice with us here at Zenways, I'm seeing this broadly three sort of types, as it were, kind of arising in terms of this initial sense of a shift of view that's leading on to practice. There are people who come and practice because life has been hard. They've been bashed around by life. There have been problems. They've been let down. They've perhaps struggled with physical problems or ill health. There's suffering in the very obvious, gross plain as the nose on your face kind of level. Then there's a sort of an opposite that seems to be there as well. There's a reasonable number of people who seem to do very well in life. They come to me and they might say something like, well, you know, I've got a great career that I love, beautiful family, kids, my wife loves me, I've ticked all the boxes that sort of go along with what our society calls success, and there's a sense in me there must be something more. This can't be it. This isn't it. I know in every fiber of my being there's more. That also is a manifestation of this sense of an unfulfilled potential. And then there's also a number of people for whom it's almost like the curtain has been drawn aside for a moment. They've had a glimpse into perhaps the reality of things or the glory of things. And this can be various things. I was talking to a lady not so long ago who had a terrible, terrible car accident. Her car stalled in the middle of a rainstorm, in the middle of a very major road, and she got rammed, a terrible storm, middle of the night, she got rammed by a huge lorry, and the car went literally flying through the air, and in this time when her car was airborne, before she landed, things opened up. She realized that the universe was very different to how she'd thought of before. And then, of course, things crashed down, terrible injuries, a lot of recovery time, but nevertheless, just for a moment, some potential had manifested. And it's not so uncommon. Perhaps in every life even, there are these moments, sometimes even these half hours, sometimes even these days or weeks in which everything sort of, boom, comes right. And then it slips through our fingers again. And then what? So that also is perhaps a manifestation of this sense of an unfulfilled potential. So this right view, this sense of something to be achieved or something to be found that's sort of not quite there yet, is, I think, beautifully expressed in the old folklore image that we use in our retreats of the hero's journey. The hero or the heroine is the person that's willing to not only recognize that there's something missing here, but is willing to go in quest of it, to, as it were, leave their village, to leave their civilization, and to go off into the wilderness to find that missing piece. And then not only that, but to bring it back, to share it for the benefit of their community. The Eightfold Path can be seen as a codification, perhaps, of this hero's or heroine's journey. So this first step, this recognizing that there's something yet to be fulfilled, is tremendously important. But as we mentioned, also this right view is something which, through walking the path, will deepen. Our view will open into a sense of how things really are, the heart of things, a knowing, a certainty, a new basis for life, which actually is not an end point, but is the beginning, if you like, or the opening of a new dimension of practice. And so this wheel, this circle, continues. Right view, the beginning, the end, the beginning, the end. So there's a sense of the whole thing coming together, the whole manifestation of a new relationship to reality in this right view that goes on, deepens as our practice continues. But the way in for most of us is the sense of suffering, this sense of an unfulfilled potential, this sense of possibility that's not yet been fully realized. right for you,